Good afternoon, Comic-Con. How we doing? We are happy to see you guys here. Thank you. It's the last day. We're about the last hour or two, and you chose to hang out and talk about LEGO NEXO Knights. So yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are you excited about that?
I know I am.
All right, we've got some good stuff. We got to, you know, going to take you behind the scenes a little bit on the development of this new property from the LEGO Group, all about the TV series, some of the models, the incredible digital experience we have. We may or may not have some sneak peeks to show you about something that no one else has seen yet. Would you guys be interested in that? Yeah. Are you sure? It doesn't sound like it. Maybe we can do that. And then we want to get some questions from you guys, the fans, at the end. So make sure you're thinking of things you want to ask now, all right? So we're going to get going. Before we start, I want to introduce all the incredible people up here on the stage with me. We've got Tommy Andreasen right here, who's the showrunner for NEXO Knights, one of the original creators of the story and concept. So welcome, Tommy.
Hello.
Mark Hoffeimeir is the incredible writer of the NEXO Knights TV series, among other things, really brings these characters to life, so great to have him here. I'm not sure about that guy in the middle, but we'll get to that after. But moving along, this is Melissa Pickering. She is a design manager for the LEGO Group, working on the incredible NEXO Knights digital experience. And then really some of the true celebrities in the LEGO world, we have two of our model designers all the way from Billund, Mark Stafford and Sam Johnson. My name's Brian Bull. I'm really happy to be part of the panel today. So we're gonna dive in. Oh, wait a minute. It's right here. Does anybody know who this guy is?
He's
Kai.
Who's Kai?
What is he doing in this room, Kai?
I don't know. I'm not Kai. What are you talking about?
Hey, that voice sounds familiar.
Hey,
who's
that?
Wait a second.
Worst picture ever.
Ladies and gentlemen, really happy to welcome back to a LEGO panel, Vincent Tong.
Yo! What's up, y'all?
Thanks for having me.
Voice of the evil and sometimes not so evil Jestro, would that be fair?
That's right, yeah. My name's Jestro. You like it? You better.
I can't believe you cast this guy.
You're stuck with me now, Buster.
All right, so we're gonna jump in. Tommy's gonna talk us through a little bit about how the concept of NEXO Knights came to be.
Yeah, and in just a while, we're gonna show you a video that's never ever been shown outside the LEGO company before, so that's a big secret. But this is actually one of the first visuals we ever made of NEXO Knight, when we thought, okay, now the ideas have come together, why don't we try to put that into a visual? So you have the team of knights, you can see they look pretty much the way they do in the show. You have Jestro, you have Murloc, the digital wizard, and you have that whole idea of NEXO power and downloading Digimagic. So there's a lot of work has gone into creating a concept like this before we made a visual, where we're trying to sum it up. And as I said, we have a small video for you that kind of introduces the whole world to you. This is the first ever little movie we did on NEXO Knights as a kind of proof of a concept. So check it out.
Thank you.
actually, we have a man with us who worked on that. That's Stu Campbell. He's sitting right there. You recognize the awkward pauses in there. That's my trademark. So sometimes I practice at home for hours in awkward pauses, like this one.
And it works. It's great.
But let's talk a little about that thing we just saw in the film, the fortress.
Yeah, so this is the, what you see here is the very first version of the fortress. We made this maybe 2 or 3 years before it was even launched onto the market. And the idea was, if knights have all this technology now, why would they need a castle that stands still? And why didn't they just take all their gear around with them? So the idea was that maybe the castle itself just drives around and takes the knights to the battle instead of them sitting waiting for the battle to come to them. And you can see we progressed from this version, which tested with kids so well, to the next one, where we were really starting to play with the color scheme and things. This one actually had a fun system where the towers turned round and they became huge cannons that could shoot rocks out, which didn't make it to the final version. But you can see here the color scheme really lending itself to the top one. There was really the final idea where we said, hey, we can make a playset out of this and not just a huge vehicle. And we showed that you could open up and play with all the knights inside. And the one at the bottom there is the finished product.
Excellent, very cool. What do we think about the Fortress?
Well, you love it. In a double sense, it was really what gave NEXO Knights wheels. I mean, once we came up with the idea for this one, that was just like, all right, I think we got something here. Now let's start to create this world, this strange mishmash of fantasy, technology, magic, a kingdom that's just been developing for thousands of years and they have technology now. So we really started to put the world together. We had to come up with the scale of this thing because we knew it's going to be big, right, Mark?
Yes.
Good answer. Good answer.
He's a writer. He's not a speaker. So that's, I don't know why we have him here. But this is the way the Fortress looks on our show. And we did a few images where we was driving around the countryside, trying to kind of sort of determine what's the scale of this sucker? How big does it need to be? This is pretty big. Here we had it going into the sunset, but then as we were working, we actually went to the cinema, and it just so happened that the cinema we went to was kind of shaped like the fortress. And that's really where we came up with the scale. So what we have here is Mark Hoffeimeir in front of the cinema in Violet, which is very close to Billund, where the LEGO Goup is placed. And we just kind of thought, hey, yeah, that's probably the scale. And you almost got run over by that.
I almost got run over by that giant movie theater.
Yeah.
Which is odd.
So the movie theater was on wheels too, is that real?
Yeah.
That's so cool.
Yeah, that's the way we roll in Denmark. You should come there. Everything is super high-tech and very inspiring.
And covered in bacon.
Yeah. But we had to come up with this world where, you know, old meets new, it's really high-tech. You know, what does a high-tech castle look like? You know, they have technology, they have power, you know, anything that is aflame, we thought, hey, we want to make this really digital. And that also ties into the whole experience that Melissa will be talking to later. But, you know, a flame is not a flame, it's made of pixels, and it's blue, and it's knights have all this technology. And like when we pitched this to Mark, I mean, we were pretty far with the concept when we brought him in and said, now we also need characters as a story. But you were like blown away, right? Right?
Yes. it was really fun for me because, you know, getting to do a mashup kind of property where you're taking the modern world, but you're also reflecting on the knight stuff so that you can do the kind of mythological knight stuff, but still have it, you know, relevant to the modern world was a lot of fun. So, like in our world, they send email, but it's called chainmail. So, so stuff like that we got to do, and it was really fun because when I first saw all the models laid out, I hadn't seen them before, and they laid them all out on the table, and I looked at them, and I was like, when can I get these? And then I had to wait.
Yeah, and you had to write first.
Yeah,
you actually have to put them in a contest before you get paid. Mark.
And they pay you in money, not in LEGO.
Ah, that's the most disappointing part. but this whole mishmash was really interesting to develop. It's like, how do you balance these things? Because we want this to look like a knight's theme as well. So we wanna be true to that, you know, big swords, helmets, horses, shields, but you wanna do it in like this new way that hasn't been done before. So you gotta balance the technology and all the modern stuff with the classic knight stuff. Which like brings us into like a horse is not a horse. That's a mega horse, or a mega steed as we call it, and that thing can turn into a motorcycle. So that's really the benefit of these guys' work over here.
Yeah, and the designer of this model is Japanese. You may be able to tell that it changes, without using the wrong word, it changes from a motorcycle into a robotic horse. And this was really, this model actually was super successful when the testing, where it was just like an icon that we didn't want to bring these animals in, and the robotic horse really set the imagination of the kids, and you know, being able to go faster by it changing into a bike.
And
really cool too.
Yeah, knights are all about armor too, so, you know, what does a knight armor look like? Yeah, make it big!
So this model here is the king's mech suit, and so he's actually in the show ending up having some cool armor, but because he's not really trained as a knight, he has no idea what he's doing, so he has to be more armored than the rest.
And again, to the Vikings, this is like a leaping point for us, because we settled on the shield, because that's, you know, we've been doing Legends of Chima, we've been doing Ninjago, but we wanted to do something with an icon that was like very specific for knights. And that's why we said, okay, the shield, that's really something only a knight has, and especially in that shape. And then the idea of a high-tech shield that can receive messages, it can receive powers, can power you up, it's a screen, it's a defense mechanism, and you can actually throw it down and use it as a hoverboard. You know, that's really what got me excited about the whole thing, like a hoverboard. And actually that's also the reason why the character Aaron Fox is called Aaron Fox, is because, hey, Marty McFly was played by Michael J. Fox, who was on a hoverboard in Back to the Future. So we're all riffing on these references.
Marty!
More vehicles, more technology, awesome stuff. You see the sword shape here.
Yep. This is the artist's rendition of Clay's Rumble Blade, which is a model I got to do. But if we move to the next slide, you can see the very first model that inspired this. On the left there is a model by a designer called Luca Capeta, who works with us. And on the right is my final Rumble Blade. Believe it or not, although they don't look alike, that's where it came from. And when I saw Luca's model, I saw it had a prism in one side and a driver in the other side, and a gun in the middle. And I was disappointed the sides didn't break off as motorcycles. And this is because I've got a bit of a reputation for two motorcycles. I did two sets for Chima where motorcycles fly out the front of it, two motorcycles in the Lion Castle.
It's become a bit of an internal joke that every time Mark makes a
I
model,
think
it has
your personal
motorcycles.
Vehicle.
Doesn't
your car break into two motorcycles?
I'm really disappointed. It's almost enough rust for it to do so.
Well, you gotta hit a tree just right, then it will break into two.
So you can see kind of how we ended up at the Rumble Blade. On the left-hand side, Luca continued experimenting with this model, and he was developing the look of NEXO Knights. So you can see as we move down there, the shield icon comes in, and then we went to a very sharp angle point on it. And then he developed all of that dark blue and the silver coming together with the trans orange in the bottom model. Meanwhile, I was playing around with the stuff on the right. You can see I instantly went away and made one where two motorcycles come on. Bit typecast. And I was also, because it was for Clay, we wanted a sword vehicle, because Claymore, that's what he's named after, a big Scottish sword. So I did a flying sword. And then my design lead came to me and he looked at Luca's model and he looked at my two models and he said, well, can you put all of this in one model? And I wept for a bit.
No.
And then I went, yeah, I'll give it a shot. And if we move to the next slide, you can see the first one where it came together. And you can see I moved away from two motorcycles because these guys were teasing me too much. But I quickly went back and we developed it. And this is about 3 months of work going in and building and rebuilding the model again and again. And so we ended up with the final model, which is what became the Rumble Blade.
It's not all fun, actually, working at LEGO, I can tell you that.
But this is all fun.
That's mostly fun, right? Come on.
Okay. Yeah, I'll give you that, Ryan. You can fire me if you want to. But you know, that's a lot of the knights and the technology, and we also need bad guys. And this is wrong. This is like we always do these concept visuals where we try to say, all right, let's put it in one picture. And this is really why we kind of decided on, okay, so versus high tech knights, we need old fashioned magic monsters. Let's make lava monsters. We showed this to a lot of kids. They like that idea, and that's, you know, then you kind of have that whole thing going. And you can see in this visual, like, there's a book of monsters, and there's a monster coming out of it. There's a Jestro, who doesn't look anything like Jestro yet, but you can see all the ideas are in there. It just needs to be worked and reworked, and then changed, and then altered, and then adjusted. It's a very long process. And all obviously these bad guys need vehicles too. So we decided to center around rock and lava and fire.
So we've learned about these bad guys and their vehicles a little bit. I think it would be good if we maybe talked about the heroes some. Anybody want to hear about the good guys? Let's hear about the heroes.
Yeah.
All right.
So we wanted a team that was like the cast on Friends, you know, the TV show, which is very dysfunctional and they have very different personalities. And so we came up with these guys, Mark.
Yeah, so I was like, you know, we got to have a group of people living in a rolling castle. You know, it's more fun if they have all kinds of crazy personalities. So, you know, we got Axel, who is big and likes to eat, but also likes to play music, right? And obviously carries the axe. And then you got Macy, who carries mace.
Kind of works out. Here?
Yeah. And she's the princess that doesn't want to be a princess, right? She wants to be a warrior, even though Dad wants her to be a princess. And she actually gets her desire to be a warrior from Mom, because Mom was a warrior. And then of course Clay Morrington is sort of the Boy Scout of our whole universe. He's sort of the one that's always telling everybody, hey, let's go train, hey, let's go beat up monsters. But he has a very sort of sly sense of humor too.
And then the direct opposite is Lance Richmond.
Lance Richmond, as one of the kids when we described Lance in a test said, he's the showboat. And I was like, yeah, exactly. So Lance is the kid that's got a little bit too much money, and he's a little bit too into himself, and he doesn't really want to do all the work that's necessary, but boy, he likes having the shiniest armor and the coolest horse, and you know, all that goes along with being sort of a celebrity knight. That's what he wants to do.
And Aaron Fox.
And Aaron Fox is of course like sort of the Tony Hawk of our world, and will do anything sort of extreme. And the problem there is he sort of always wants to try the most challenging way to do something, even if it's not the best way to do something. And he doesn't always take everything seriously. So that's where Clay has to dial him back a little bit. So, you know, when we created these characters and then stuck them in the Fortrex, you know, we kind of knew we got axes and we got swords and we got maces. And in general, if you just leave it at that, that leads to sort of that, like, mayhem, you know, bashing. And so we wanted to have the fun with them and make them, you know, complaining about, you know, who's cooking the burrito in the microwave and who, you know, who's watching, who left the Holovision on last night and what, you know, where are we going to go for breakfast and that kind of stuff. So to that end, I just wanted to give a shout out to, we worked with a lot of talented writers who wrote for the show. A lot of the writers who have worked on stuff like How to Train Your Dragon and Justice League Action, and a lot of great shows out there. And if they could just raise their hands if they're here, I wanted to give them a shout out. There's Ernie Altbacher.
Yay, Ernie!
And Dave McDermott.
Yay!
And Andrew Robinson. And FM DeMarco. And Jack Thomas and John Derevlaney. And John Derevlaney happened to be the head writer on Chima, so it's kind of fun to have that carrying on that nice LEGO-y tradition.
But we know when we have good guys, then bad guys are really important. And that's where we get this guy on board. I mean, yeah, we want someone really quirky, and then we just happened upon this guy.
Just happened upon me, and I was like, hey, give me the job. And I'm like, okay.
Yeah, and that's maybe not the voice we really want there.
No, that's true.
So we settled on the Jester because we wanted a bad guy that was, you know, you would like him almost as much as the good guys. So we would want one that was like really fun, and then we got the idea, well, if he has a book of monsters, why don't we make a monster out of the book? So that became a character, which was like really something that brought those two to life. And actually the next year is, that's the very first drawing that was ever done of Jestro and Book of Monsters together. And you see all the horrible, horrible puns that just made it into the show and became part of its DNA.
Shut your Facebook.
Can we say that? I guess we can.
It's if you pause enough when you say
Facebook. That's true, alright.
And whenever we developed it, it was like Mark was always, we were also always acting it out, so he was always kind of the book. And doing the voice of the book, and then Jeff, hey,
you mind putting this on?
I'm not gonna wear that. Put it on, clown boy, put it on. Okay. Let's see how it looks.
And just as a way of explanation, the voice of the Book of Monsters is my tribute to Stan Lee, because I worked with Stan for years on Spider-Man the Animated Show and on Superhero Squad. So for some reason, when I thought we have to have a crazy, wacky monster book, just Stan Lee sort of came out in a very twisted way. Hey, clown boy.
Yeah, what do you want?
Hey, why did you attack the Hamlet of Omelette before breakfast? I wanted some eggs.
Well, I was hungry. I just went over there and I had to eat before you.
Oh, so great. You know, we've got to go on to Bucket Bird next, and I'm going to be starving.
Yeah, but I'm really full. Thank goodness.
Yeah, you're full of something, kid.
Ah, shut your face, book. Hey,
I'm glad you added the pause, or it would be legally actionable.
No problem. I read the disclaimer. I signed the NDA. Don't worry about it.
I worry about everything you do.
You should do.
You know, the funny thing about Jestro, when I first auditioned for Jestro, I was... What we do sometimes when we don't go into the actual booth for the audition, we have to send in MP3s. Do you guys know what MP3s are? Yeah, probably, right? Because you guys don't know what cassettes are anymore. So I was in my closet, and I was like, because my studio was in my closet, and it's like sweaty. I'm like, oh my gosh, I gotta put more auditions on the MP3s. And so I read the description. So we didn't get a picture of Jestro. I didn't know what Jestro looked like. But they got this description, and he was supposed to be, he sounded sort of like Steve Buscemi slash the guy from Princess Bride. Like, inconceivable!
Yeah, Wallace Shawn.
Yeah. And then so I was like looking up a bunch of these things, and I was like slowly just kind of came into this guy. This dude right here. I was like, what the heck is this? This doesn't sound like anything like a jester or an evil villain would. But I got the job. So, thank you.
And what's really great is, you know, not only did Vincent work on Ninjago and then on here, but the voice of the Book of Monsters, Mark, is also Gamaron, right?
He's Garmadon, that's
Garmadon,
right.
Garmadon, sorry.
Yeah, yeah, and when you guys cast me as Jestro, you said you didn't know that I played Kai.
No, so. you're not that famous, dude. Oh.
Wow. It's all about love here in London, I know.
Did you audition for any of the knights too?
Yeah, I didn't get him though.
We couldn't use his. He's a typical bad guy, right?
Exactly.
Here's the great thing though, in upcoming episodes like The Book of Monsters and Jestro, they'll sing. They'll do all kinds of crazy stuff. If you go online and look at some of the digital shorts, The Book of Monsters plays the harmonica. And I'm very good at playing the harmonica. And so we've been able to have a lot of fun with having someone as talented as Vincent there to like, I'll do some singing and I'll do some other crazy takes on stuff, and it's been really, really fun.
Yeah.
Great, excellent. I think now, Tommy, let's talk about some of the other characters, yeah?
Yeah, well, we're gonna skip this video because we're running short on time. We want to take some questions from you, but this guy, Murloc 2.0, now, have you ever before seen a digital wizard? No? That was a leading question. So we came up with this guy, really interesting. He would have a new type of magic. It really was something that we could like work with here, because we wanted this digital NEXO Knight, futuristic knight, so futuristic wizard who has these awesome powers. That's where we came up with the NEXO powers. He can actually send a new type of digitized magic to our knights. How awesome is that? We came up with the name NEXO Power because we could get it legally approved.
Because the lawyer said it was okay, kids. Mm-hmm. So, Melissa, can you kind of dive in, kind of talking about how the TV series and the characters that come to life there, and the toys and the physical products, the shields there, all translate and kind of come to life as these NEXO powers within the NEXO Knights app game?
Yes. So, just as you can play out the NEXO Knights world physically in the physical toy, you can do the same with a battle game. It's a free app. And it's not just any battle game though, because you can actually scan in all of the NEXO powers that the knights are using in their battle against Jestro and the lava monsters. And then when you scan in the powers, you can use them in your battle game against Jestro and the lava monsters. There are almost 200 NEXO powers out there, meaning things like Egg of Doom and Chicken Power, Fire Tornado and Sword Tornado. Some of them are really powerful and some of them are really funny. And you can find them anywhere, just like you can search for hundreds of Pokemons. You can actually scan in hundreds of powers. And we have them in magazines, posters.
In a book of monsters, perhaps?
Monsters.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And
I have one on my t-shirt.
Yeah.
So if you have the app on your phone, you can come and scan Tommy's shirt for a power after this, okay?
And what's even cooler is in a few minutes, you will have an exclusive viewing of a power that no one else has seen. Yeah.
So get ready for NEXO scan.
That's right. And if you don't have the NEXO app yet, knowing you will have it very soon, what you can do is take a picture on the screen, capture that NEXO power on the screen. Then when you go home, download the app, the free app over Wi-Fi, you can then scan that into your game later on. So, but we'll get to that point, we'll remind you again.
But first we have a video that really shows you the entire NEXO Knights experience with the toys and everything. You can even scan from the TV show, which we are immensely proud of. We believe we are the first to do that. We hope, believe, I don't know.
We're the first ones in this room to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're the first to claim it.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Some powers on the evil monsters with the new LEGO NEXO Knights app. The more NEXO powers you scan, the more powerful you become. Upgrade your power. Be a hero. Download the app for free. Ask your parents first.
We like to torment this guy.
Did that hurt? Scene? Yeah.
A little bit, yeah. I'm such a method actor, I smashed my face a couple dozen times.
So I think we have our next video now will actually be our scannable power, correct?
Yes, yes. And it's and actually it's a very powerful moment in the when the knights are in battle, they are able to actually defeat the lava monsters, so they have to call upon the magical wizard Murloc in order to get a power. So this power at moment that the knights play out, you can also play out. And again, if you don't have the app, just snap a picture when you see it come up on the screen, and then you'll be able to scan it in.
Who's ready for an exclusive first look San Diego Comic-Con NEXO power? Yeah! All right. guy. Get your phone. Get your phone.
Get your phones out.
Here we go.
Get away from me! Get away from me!
Snakes. Why do they have to be snakes?
I didn't know you were afraid of snakes.
And it's not snakes. It's a basilisk. It was wrong about you. You must remember, Clay, whatever doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
Kill me?
I guess most sayings don't stand up to close scrutiny. What I meant to say, use this lesson to make you stronger.
Getting to the point, we're just about ready to take your questions. We got a couple more slides to go. Tommy, we've seen Mark have some fun with the Book of Monsters. Can you tell us a little bit about the different ways of storytelling that we're doing, you know, kind of bringing out the NEXO story?
Well, yeah, as you see in the TV show, we deal a lot with lava monsters, but that's not the only thing that's in the book. That's just what we're doing in the TV show. So we thought it would be fun to have Mark as a writer actually explore what else is in the book.
There's all sorts of other stuff in the book. So the cool thing was, when we did this Book of Monsters to sort of supplement the television show, we added all kinds of different classes of monsters that you won't find in the television show. So, but these are monsters that exist in the book, and hey, maybe in the future we might see them. We don't know. So you get to see all kinds of crazy, like sea creatures and forest monsters, and they're all in the Book of Monsters. It's pretty cool. Get your copy today!
Also, it's written from the point of view of the book, so it's actually pretty evil and sarcastic. It's very fun read. And you can role play to be this guy, because this is like actually having the real Book of Monsters. Then you can play.
Hours of fun, kids! Hours of fun! And you get to read and learn!
and I won't make you evil, I promise.
Yeah, right.
All right, we've come to a very important part of this panel presentation, but it's going to require one question of you guys. Are you ready to see a sneak peek of the next season of NEXO Knights? I don't know. I couldn't really hear that. Can you do the honors?
Can you guys make some noise for the next sneak peek for NEXO Knights?
And their forces of evil are at it again. Did you really think it was over?
I don't think. I attack. Now let's tear this place apart.
In search of more magical books, they hit the Kingdom of Nightmare harder than ever before. Fortunately, the NEXO Knights are prepared. With daring courage, upgraded equipment, new NEXO powers, dramatic arrivals, and heroic one-liners.
Knights, we must defend Stein!
Well, that's your best line yet. Sounded more heroic in your head, didn't it?
Their relentless battle continues. But with an ever-growing army of hot-headed monsters, Jestro in the Book of Monsters...
Now it's snowing, now it ain't. Now it's snowing, now it ain't. Now it's...
...are just getting warmed up. The NEXO Knights are back in Season 2. Armor up!
All right! And Season 2 will return to Cartoon Network on August 13th, so be ready. Now, speaking of being ready, if anyone has any questions for any of these panelists, please step up to the microphone. We've got a question for Vincent, for Jestro, for the Book of Monsters, for anyone up here. We'd love to hear your questions.
All right,
Stormtrooper.
When you were thinking about Jestro, I saw the different
the different gesture of, I guess, like, of the idea of what he looked like. Mm-hmm. How did you come up with the right one?
How did I come up with the right one? I think it was a very interesting process because originally Jestro was just like a jester that wasn't very good at anything. And then he gets sort of peer pressured and like manipulated by the Book of Monsters, which makes him very, very evil. So I had to go into this deeper, darker, a bit scarier place. And boy, was it fun!
And we had different ideas that he would have those two personalities. We had a version up there, I guess you saw, where his head would actually turn every time, his switch personality, but we decided not to go that route with the design.
Somebody stole that for the LEGO movie, I think.
We had it first.
And then also, why lava monsters?
Why lava monsters?
Sam?
Why not?
And we actually tested loads and loads and loads of different types of monster, and it turned out that the kind of lava creature thing that we had going was something that, you know, kids had not really seen for really a long time. We only really tested the water with power miners, and we really found that it was such a strong thing that we could really make them something really cool and give them lots of cool personalities just based on this kind of lava fire effect. And so you end up with lots of cool characters, all with different abilities and personalities in it.
They
were hot.
Yeah. Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Of all the monsters in the app, do you think Jestro would be the hardest one, or a different monster than Jestro would be the hardest one to take down?
You know what? I think Jestro would be the hardest one to take down because all he would do is send other monsters out constantly, and he'd probably just sit on his throne and wait for those baddies, which are the goodies.
Melissa actually knows this. She's designed the game.
Oh, yeah. Take it away, Melissa!
Whipperella is actually what I feel is the toughest. Some people can't win against Flamma. Yeah.
Thank you.
They've all been very sneakiest.
Whipperella is just a great name, too. Yeah.
I was wondering if we're ever going to see Jestro win in an episode. Well, the answer to that is stay tuned here in the second season because I think you might get to see that, yeah.
What, there's a second season? Nice.
He'll grow stronger and better.
But it's really me winning and not him.
Do we think we're ever going to see, like, dragons in NEXO Knights?
Ooh, dragons. Well, we have another show called Ninjago that has dragons in it. Isn't that enough for you?
No! More dragons.
We may do at one point. We'll definitely stop introducing more and more varied monsters. So not all ladder monsters all the time. We're going to have snot monsters at some point.
In season one, there have been like, they said that there have been knight graduations for thousands of years. So how come when Jestro shows up with his book of monsters, those five knights are the only ones that show up?
Hitting us with the logic stick.
Well done, man. Well done.
It's funny because we were actually asked that question at one point in time during the presentation. The reason there aren't a ton of knights, and in fact, in the second season, we're gonna meet some other knights, and we're gonna get to go, to the Knights Academy and meet some other knights. But the main reason there aren't a ton of knights out there anymore is because there haven't been any monsters to fight for hundreds of years. So without any monsters, you know, a knight has to go do some other stuff, like become a movie star or, you know, sell used hover horses, that kind of thing. So we will meet other knights, but primarily that's sort of the problem in this kingdom is they haven't worried about it for so long that they just got this group of young newbies.
They got lazy.
If you were to invent a new knight, what color would it be and what personality would it have?
I think we already did that.
Universal.
I think
I like purple.
I think we already have a product out on the shelves, which is one of the account exclusives. I think it might be Toys R Us exclusive, which is called the Black Knight. which Mark actually designed. And I don't think at this time we can reveal who the Black Knight is, but you could buy the LEGO set and find out.
Thanks, hello, how are you?
Good.
I was curious, when I was a kid, it was a big deal if you found a blue 2x4 piece of LEGO, and these days there's a million different types of LEGO parts. Can the builders maybe comment on the process of when you're coming up with a set, how do you get from we need a squiggly thing with a giant hook on it to getting it approved by the corporate offices and that sort of process?
It actually starts when we talk about new bricks. It actually starts where we actually have a cap on how many we're allowed to make, because we can't make endless and endless bricks. And, you know, it's a LEGO system, so we want to be able to build and build and build as much as possible. Actually, my girlfriend who sat in the audience is one of the people who polices that in the LEGO company.
Boom! Ooh, that girl right there.
So Sam has to do the dishes if he wants a new element.
Yeah. But we're really trying to keep LEGO classic and keep it what you remember from your childhood and your kids will remember from their childhood on and on forever. And yeah, so we try, it's an achievement if you can get a 2x4 brick, like, yes, we got one in, because we really want it to be classic LEGO as well as totally
new. For NEXO Knights, we were looking for a new language, but still a classic one. And we realized we'd never done any elements that came to a sharp point at the front. So we actually designed a little pyramid, and then there's two other elements which both come to that point at the front. Gives it a very different look, but it still looks like classic LEGO. We're always trying to find things like that.
Without spoiling anything, only a yes or no answer would be good enough. Is the Book of Monsters Monstrucks?
How can we answer that without spoiling it? Tune in to Cartoon Network!
Or just announce a Purple Knight, that'd be great too.
We're working on a Purple Knight, we're not sure it's gonna be made.
And there's so many exciting twists and turns coming in Season 2 on Cartoon Network.
On Cartoon Network. Okay. Thank you.
I'll tell you, if you keep watching, you will have that question answered.
Okay.
Yeah. There you go.
And I like the way you think, man.
What is your favorite NEXO Knight?
Nice question. Good question.
What's your favorite NEXO
Knight? Mine is Aaron.
Mine is Macy, actually.
I like Lance. He's funny.
Macy.
I like Clay. I'm a bit boring.
I really like Lance.
Yeah, there we go.
Showboat.
Yeah. Thank you.
Great question.
One more question.
Final question.
If there was a purple ninja, who would? If there was a purple knight, who would it be?
Purple ninja knight. Who would it be? I'm not a writer.
We've got some choices, right? We got Ava. We got Robin, right? And this coming season, when we visit the Knights Academy, we might see some other ones.
He said purple. Do you know who was purple? That was Prince. You know, a princess, wouldn't you want a prince? Maybe a purple prince? Wouldn't that be great?
I could do that. I don't know.
Talk to the lawyers, Tommy. Thank you guys. Thank you all very much.
Thank you so much, everybody!
Enjoy the rest of your Comic-Con, and we'll see you August 13th for Season 2 on Cartoon Network!